Next, the last in our series of interviews with Democrats who were voted out of office this year. Veteran lawmaker James Oberstar of Minnesota has served in Congress for nearly four decades. Just before the 111th Congress came to a close, the powerful chairman of the Transportation Committee sat down with our Judy Woodruff.
Congressman James Oberstar, thank you for sitting down to talk with us.
Well, it's a privilege to join you. Thank you for inviting me.
So leaving the Congress after 18 terms, what happened to you?
There was a wave, no question about it. I've seen other waves. There was one in 1974.
That swept you in.
That was the year I lost the party endorsement, but I ran in the primary, and my theme was the people will decide. They did in 1974. They decided again this year, and the outcomes were very different. But as Thomas Jefferson said, taking a group through the Capitol after he had left the presidency, stopped at the door to the House chamber and said, "Here, sir, the people rule. The people rule."
A lot of voters said in this election, we are frustrated, we're even angry at Washington. We don't think Washington is listening to us. Is that anger, that frustration justified?
Nationwide, yes. And in this era of the BlackBerry, when you have instant communication, people expect instant results. I think that's a very large part of it. With the Obama presidency and the commitment to the stimulus, people expected to see jobs turn around. I think the Democrats overall overstated what they could deliver. That we'd have unemployment down, we'd have jobs created. The tax cut that was part of the stimulus, I have yet to find someone who realizes that he or she got a tax cut. And at least one person who said, "Oh, but we have to give it back." So we didn't message it right. We didn't deliver aggressively to the people the message of the jobs created. But there's no denying the 1,300,000 construction jobs, 35,000 lane miles of highway built, and 12,500 transit buses purchased, and 1,200 bridges repaired. But there wasn't enough of that all over the country.
Having said that, people were saying, "We think government's wasting our money. Government is spending more than we want it to spend.
That money
should be kept with the taxpayers."
That message was delivered. It was a very effective message on the part of the Republicans, but they're talking about the TARP, $750 billion
in the
troubled asset recovery program. Nearly all of that money is being paid back. All but, say, $35 billion, and I think much of that will come back yet, with interest for the taxpayer. But somehow we were not effective in getting the message across to the public that TARP is being repaid, General Motors is repaid, they've come back into private ownership, the jobs are 55,000 jobs created in the automotive sector, but we somehow didn't message it right.
Looking forward, you have voters saying, and members of Congress coming to Washington saying, "My mandate is to stop things from happening." How do you reconcile that with the kinds of things you're talking about where government was active? Is that the role of Congress, basically, to listen to individual members' constituents, or is it to think about the greater the needs of the country overall?
Those are two themes. The Constitution protects the right, quote, of the citizens to petition their government for redress of grievances. Anytime a person or a group writes to me or any of my colleagues, they're petitioning their government for a redress of a grievance they have or a need they feel. But it was Edmund Burke, a British political scientist, who wrote, "There are two roles, agent and representative. Which of those do you follow? Are you to represent, or are you an agent strictly limited to only that message you hear from the people? The representative is the larger view you talked about of looking at beyond your needs, the needs of your district or the voice
and
of your district.
How do you reconcile?
That's your challenge as a member of Congress.
How optimistic are you that the government as it now works in this city of Washington can serve the needs of this country and its people going forward?
I think there has to be a meeting of the minds. I think there has to be a recall of the era of the 60s, 70s, and even before that, when members of Congress sat with each other, understood each other, got to know each other as people, to trust one another, to look squarely in the eye and say, I understand what your views are, and we can find a common path. That view, that participatory democracy, that sense of give and take with trust in one another has dissipated in the last decade.
So how do they get it back?
Members have to spend more time here in Washington getting to know one another. When I started...
But many of them are saying they're not moving to Washington.
When I started on the Hill in 1956, members of Congress had one paid trip back to their district per year. They had to find other ways. They had to go home, but they had to find other ways of getting there. Now it's a three-day session per week. And members want to come here on Tuesday night and vote and want to leave Thursday night. That is not conducive. Committee hearings can't be held properly. You can't hear the voice of the people on the public issues to be debated. You need more time to work with one another.
And can that happen?
It can, but it's going to take a lot of moving and coming to understand one another.
You served in Congress for 36 years, 18 terms. What do you feel you're leaving behind, you've left behind here?
Oh, so much. So many, both in the legislative arena and in the community service arena, to the casework of Jim Rose's, a World War II veteran who should have had, but never did receive his Silver Star, appealed to me. And the day I presented that Silver Star to him for his heroism and his tears rolling down his cheeks, you can never take that away. But in the legislative arena, the Safe Routes to School initiative that I launched to attack childhood obesity and type 2 diabetes. We have Safe Routes to School in 10,000 schools across America. We're going to be able to change the habits of an entire generation of Americans. The bicycling provisions, the safety in aviation, the aging aircraft review that I initiated in 1990. All of those are accomplishments of which I am immensely proud and can never be taken away.
Representative James Oberstar, thank you very much for talking with us.
My pleasure.
When Congress convenes next month, we'll talk with members of the new Republican majority.